Nancy Gaynor, working here part-time. Housekeeping, I think all of you already did, but make sure you sign in, please. I will count your heads a number of times and probably come up with a number of different totals, even though it's a small room. Math is not my forte. But I need you to sign in so that I can pester you with emails, but also so that we can justify having programs. There is a program evaluation sheet that I think many of you picked up. If you didn't, it's over here by the sign-in sheet. If you would do that, please, it would be helpful, and especially that lower question, suggestions for future programs would be much appreciated. You should have also gotten the handout for today. Anybody need it? Okay. So I have a biography that Eric very kindly supplied me with, so I will. Eric Basir owns a photo retouching studio in Evanston, Illinois. He's served the genealogical community since 2002 as a teacher and author of 3 books and multiple videos about digital photo preservation and restoration. We had Eric here, I think he told me recently, 3 years ago, 2.5 years ago, and that's why he's back again, on top of the fact that I didn't take him up on his services then, and I really need to, because some of my photos are disappearing. Especially, I've got a tintype that's spooky, if any of you were here before. And I have actually another one here for him to do. So we'll let him get going and get to see the magic that you can do with bringing back your photos. So, Eric, welcome. And I will. Do you want all lights off?
Is that it, good? I don't know. What about you all? Is that okay? Is that all right? All right, so let me just take a quick peek at the camera again. There's a light did change. I just want to make sure. I record perfect. I think that's perfect. I record all of these events, and let me just adjust the exposure here a little bit. I record all of these little talks I do. They're on my YouTube channel. You can go to my website. And on the website, you'll see Learn Photo Retouching. And you go there, and then you'll see a bunch of other little things. One of them is watch videos on demand. So I've got hundreds of videos. And I got the video here. You can search 2013 Cary, Eric Basir, something like that, and you'll find it. We got an email list in the back if you want to join. It's a great way to stay in touch. I send it out every other month, and when this video is online, you will get a notification in there, in that newsletter. Now, everyone here brought a lot of old pictures and documents. So I gave you a handout, and it's titled Photo Restoration Do's and Don'ts. If you can almost memorize these do's and don'ts, it will save you so much stress and anxiety when it comes to your photos that you've brought here today. And I don't really want to go over all of that stuff that's in there, because I really want to address all of your specific problems. This will be an open forum. That is, if you have a question, please raise your hand. I want to get to it right away. But most importantly, I want to show you some things that we can do to restore the pictures, how you could do it yourself. How many of you have flatbed scanners, scanners that look like this at home? Raise your hand, all right? How many of you don't have a scanner at home? All right, don't feel bad, all right? Quick recommendation is all of you should have flatbed scanners. And you shouldn't just have any flatbed scanner. My recommendation is a brand called Epson, E-P-S-O-N. All right, and you can email me for all the details, and pretty much an Epson flatbed scanner, any Epson flatbed scanner is going to be fine for you. The software I'm using, one second, is Adobe Photoshop Elements. Adobe Photoshop Elements. Not Adobe Photoshop CS or Creative Cloud. I'm not on the cloud. I'm on solid ground, so I don't rent my software anymore. But that's what I recommend. Yes, ma'am, in the back.
The 3-in-1, the Epson, like the printer, the scanner, is that the same talking about?
You're in a safe range. You're in a safe range. My only issue with the 3-in-1s is I don't know if they do negatives. I don't know if it scans negatives. I doubt it, but I'd have to, if anyone here knows.
Well, I had an old scanner. I'm not sure what the brand was. I'm pretty sure it was Epson, but I did have one that actually had a negative attachment to do negatives with.
Great.
But it's so old, I haven't been able to figure out how to upgrade it to my computer.
Yeah.
It was sitting there being wasted.
All right. Boy, that's rough when you got the hardware that works, but the operating system, the computer, ignores it.
Yeah.
That's really frustrating.
Well,
if you want, send me an email. Tell me what computer you do have, your operating system, and the scanner model, and maybe I could just do a quick little search, and maybe point you in the right direction.
Oh, that's yeah. Wonderful.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
I can say though, when I upgraded a computer, we had a 3-in-1, and I lost the scan function.
Yeah.
See.
This isn't a 3-in-1. This is strictly a scanner, but it does do negatives. It's a flatbed scanner like that.
Yeah.
But it does the negatives.
So you know, send it to me. Do you know which scanner it is, by the way?
No,
Okay.
I wish I'd looked
it's okay.
Before I came.
It's okay. It's fine. All right. So let's get started and talk briefly. I'm going to throw out some a couple. You know, actually, let me get this handout just so I. You know, I use these things and I update them, but I pretty much use the same thing and I try to memorize everything I'm doing. So I'm just going to go over this briefly. Handle your pictures properly. That is, if you can have a glove like cotton glove, great. If you don't have a cotton glove, hold the picture by the sides, okay? You don't have to go like this. Here, look it. No. Just hold it away from the face, okay? Especially on the borders if you can do that, all right? We talked about the scanner, and just trust me, Epson. Don't go cheap, Epson. Don't go with HP either, please. HP's got some quirky thing where even if it's saved in one way, if you tell it to save in one way, it saves in another. Trust me, it's just a hassle. HP is great for scanning everything except your family photos. I'm sorry to say, Mr. HP, but this is just how it is for you right now. Don't scan in grayscale. Always scan in color. We're going to show that in a second. And remember to put the original in the center of the glass. This is not a photocopy. All right, if it's put in the center of the glass, you'll have more coverage from that little light that goes under there. Scan at least 300 pixels per inch. And don't use any of the color filters, any fancy color restoration. Try not to use any filters in the scanner, unless you're scanning something that comes out of a magazine, a picture out of a newspaper, a picture out of a magazine. There's something called a de-screening filter. All right, that's acceptable. But I don't give any credence to any other filters in your scanner for your family photos at this time. Now, there's one tip that I didn't put in here that I don't know why it's not in here. It's in some of my other handouts, but this is called a don't for scanning. So you're gonna have to write this down. Don't save as JPEG. Yep, I'm serious. I want you to, after that, so don't save as JPEG, period. Do save as TIFF, TIFF. Tax incremental, no, I'm kidding. Yeah, it's tagged image format. Tagged image format, TIFF, that's a file format. Let me just write something down here, update handout for TIFF. All right, very important. I want you to use a photo editing program like Photoshop Elements. However, there's also PaintShop Pro. There's also GIMP. There's also others. And if you want to spend, I don't know, $10, $15, $20 a month, you can rent Adobe Photoshop and probably use 5% of it to get what you could get done with Elements. We're going to focus on a couple little restoration techniques here. I will not mention until we actually start doing the work. All right, did I see a hand? No. No? Yes.
I wanted to ask you on the de-screening.
Yes.
What does that mean?
So a de-screening, what it will do, when we scan something that is already printed in a newspaper or magazine, you know it's not really a photo. All it is little dots. Yeah, it's little dots. And what happens, that scanner doesn't read it so well. And what ends up happening is you get this weird blending, wavy swirlies inside. And you're like, it doesn't look like that. And that's because of the de-screening pattern. Now, I do a little thing called Scanning 101. That's a different workshop, so you'll have to bring me back. But I go through everything about scanning, all right? And in fact, if you go on the website, again, you can look up Scanning 101 on my YouTube channel, and you'll find quite a few going back a few years. Now, let's get started. So there's a couple things I want to talk about. We had this one here. And this is not exactly a photo. This is not a photo. But it's something that could apply to a photo. And this is a bill, a fee bill. One of the students that came today, this was her ancestors. He was a doctor. So this was the fee bill he would keep in his office. All right. The only issue is that the paper is turning yellow. There's these weird spots. There's little mold and insects eating it. Look in the back of the frame. It's like, oh, there's a like a feast for all the little insects with all this glue. So what you got to do, all right, you got to take out the nails and whatnot. Hopefully it's not stuck to the glass. Now, how do you know if something's stuck to the glass? Anyone know? So you'll see like a little ring around there, and you'll be like, that doesn't look like the rest of it. There's some ring in the glass. That means it's stuck. If that's the...
Just so I can, in the angles that you're holding at it, I can see little spots.
Up here?
Like they're stuck. No, that here. Look like they're stuck to the glass.
Yeah.
Pieces that are stuck to the glass already, I can see it.
Yeah, okay, all right. Well, you know, you got to be careful. And depending how bad it is, you might want to scan it first, then start taking it out. Just in case you ruined the thing, at least you scanned it with glass on it. All right? Then you take all of it, take it out, you know, being real careful, of course. And I'm not going to pull this one out. All right? And you got to scan it, and you scan it in parts. All right? And you scan one part this way, you scan another part this way, another this way, another this way. And then when you have a nice photo editing program like Photoshop Elements or PaintShop Pro or one of them, it has a nice little filter to help stitch all those images together back into the one size. All right? And that's something I wanted to go over for this.
Eric, is there anything special you need to do if you are trying to scan something that's framed because of the glare of the glass? Is that going to be overexposed when the bar comes through on the
scanner? Sometimes it depends. Usually it doesn't pick it up.
Okay.
As long as the glass is sitting on the glass. The glass of the frame is sitting on the glass of the scanner.
So you might have to take it apart enough to get rid of the frame.
Well, yeah, because the frame could make the glass up a little bit. But you try it. You just try it and see what happens. That's all. The best thing, before you start taking things apart, scan them at each stage. And eventually, after a while, you get used to the process. And you're like, oh, it's not so bad. It's like using a dishwasher for the first time. You know, like, ugh, I need the manual. You know, and it's like, it's only three steps. But you want to do it right. You don't want to mess it up. Eventually, it becomes easier to handle. All right, let's get started. Yes?
I have a photograph that someone sent to me. And I think they took a picture with a camera of the original, and so there's some discoloration. It looks sort of funny.
It's a copy shot.
Yeah.
with a camera, and there's this.
My quick question is there a way to fix that?
Did you bring that?
It's on my phone.
It's on your phone? Yeah. All right, so why don't you open it up on your phone? Because it's, I'm guessing, I'm like really guessing. I need to know.
Okay, I'll show you.
So do that, okay? Yeah, that would be good. All right, so here we have a picture that has all kinds of problems that many of you have the same. It's got discolorization, it's broken, or it's got rips. We want to, and it's a postcard. And it's got writing on the back.
That's my main problem. I can't read the writing on the back, and I wondered if you can
with quill
enhance that somehow.
Yeah, all right, that's a great question. Thank you. All right, so what I do is I will actually put it on the flatbed scanner a little separate, all right? So actually, I want to go a little bit like that. I don't want to try to put it back together on the scanner, because I know I'm going to do that with my photo editing program. So I have my Epson driver here, and the first thing I do is I click preview here. And preview is going to tell me, is going to show me everything that's on the glass. And the scanner's warming up. Any questions?
What do you think of those flip-pal things that you can buy and travel with?
Flip-pal. So if you go to my website, I have a blog. And you click on the blog and search FlipPal, and I have a review, and I show some comparisons. I compare this scanner to the FlipPal scanner. And you get to see and judge for yourself. Personally, I think it's a really good tool. But don't, at this stage, it will not replace one of these right now, current technology, as far as getting quality. That's my opinion. And be careful getting stuck with their proprietary software, the software that they have. You know, make sure that you're not, whatever you're doing with it, you have your original JPEGs or TIFF scans, okay? Because if their software, if they go out of business or they stop using it, it's going to be hard for you to work with what you have.
Photoshop,
right.
With your scan.
Yeah, yeah. Use Photoshop with your scans, right. All right, so I'm going to click I have all my settings here. Let me check my settings, make sure I don't have any of those weird filters on. I don't. All right, and my resolution is at 300 dpi or ppi. And my size, I'm going to keep it at the original size for today. But sometimes what I like to do is enlarge it up here in the scale section. So I'll be at 300 ppi, but because it's a small print, sometimes I like to go 200%. And you'll see it'll change the target size. It changes the final size to, you know, about 12 inches wide. But for demonstration purposes, let's leave it at 100. Because if it's a bigger scan, it takes longer. And that slows us down, and we don't have all day. So I'm going to use this neat little feature in Epson, in its driver, and I designate a folder to save it to. And I'm going to call this folder CAPL for Cary Area Public Library, and I'll put 2016. And and then I click choose. And it's going to give a prefix. It's actually going to assign every scan I do today with this number, starting at 1. And my image format is a TIFF. Notice, this is very important, everybody. Right here at the scan, don't scan as JPEG and then save it as a TIFF. Please save it as a TIFF from the scan, right at the beginning. Because your JPEG format is what they call lossy compression. So it gives you a small file size that's more manageable, easier to email in some cases, or upload. But it averages out the colors. And what happens is over time, if you start working on that picture, you close it, I mean, you save it, you close it, you open it again, you work on it again, you save it, you close it. Every time you do that, it averages out the colors even more. So it's like, oh, I scanned 3,000 pictures as JPEG. Now you're telling me I have to do it as TIFF. I said, hold on. All right? I'm not asking you to rescan or resave. I'm asking you to do this. If you're going to work on it, save it as a TIFF. All right? Because that way, every time you work on it, save it, close it, it won't degrade in quality. All right? But every time you work on a JPEG, 2, 3, 4, 5 times, a little thing I'm doing, it makes it worse. All right? So let's scan the other side of this card, because really she brought this in just to try to understand what's on the back for the handwriting. So I want to do both. And click preview. Any questions?
When you selected the TIFF in the drop-down,
right,
there was a multi-TIFF selection also.
Yeah.
What is that?
Yeah. Yeah. I don't understand that thing at all. I don't know. I looked in the help and it didn't help me much. I was like, I don't get it. So, and that doesn't mean it's useless, but you know, look, I'm short, okay? There's only so many things I can reach. So I'm not saying it doesn't exist or it's not important, but it's just like, I don't get it. So, okay. So here's our postcard backside, and I want to hit scan. And here's what she was talking about. She said multi-TIFF and all this print mat. TIFF. It's all I need to know. Is it water? Yes. Give it to me. So, real simple there. Any questions? Yeah. Ah, yeah.
If you're scanning just regular, you know, like you've got this photo on the wall, these old, but you want the photos into your computer, can you just, because I've got that, like that 3-in-1, the HP with the, with the three, you know, the printing and the scanning, and can I just use that? I mean, is it okay to, I know the Epson scanner's better, but can you just scan it on that?
You're talking about using the HP 3-in-1? The quality is just.
If I don't want to work on it.
If you don't want to work on it, but it's still, the quality is just not there. I don't know what they're doing. Okay. I don't understand.
Approximately like what the Epson sell for?
You could get this for probably $100 or $150. Yeah, this flatbed here with a negative scanner, you know, and a slide attachment.
So that's what I'm not even going to bother with trying to figure out my old.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So.
Okay. So it's not really even worth, if you're not going to work on it or enhance it or do anything, it's still not even really worth just.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I cannot recommend HP for archival photo scanning.
Okay.
I hate to say it. I mean, I use HP. I use it for everything but that. You know, I scan my drawings, but my drawings are in pencil and I'm gonna ink them on the computer. You see what I mean? So that's it. But I would never scan my family photos with that HP.
All right. I think you're emphatic about that.
Yeah, I'm serious, I am emphatic. I'm sorry, I'm a little emotional about it.
So you've used an HP.
Yes, I have a new HP. I have a new HP OfficeJet 8620. It still is like, what are you guys doing? I don't get it. I don't understand why they haven't.
The quality of the lens that they're reproducing.
It's their software. It's their software. Something is saving things as JPEG, and then you, even though you're telling it TIFF. In the software, it's making, it's a TIFF.
It's default.
But it's somehow in there. It compresses it and everything, and it's gummy and. I'm sorry. Okay.
Can slides.
Slides. I'm sorry.
Like slides.
Yes, this has a slide attachment right in here. This is actually an older one, so you get a newer one, and I would say spend a little more than the cheapest.
Okay.
Just to get a little extra features, a little, just to keep yourself up there as far as being able to lay down a lot of slides would be nice. It would be nice to lay down 6 slides and scan them.
Yeah.
Okay, believe me, you'd like that. Okay, so let's do a little work on this just to talk about some problems, all right? So, now, this is gonna be fast, okay? So you're not gonna catch a lot of what I'm doing, all right? And this is not really a tutorial type of class, it's more like I'm showing you what you're capable of, okay? So first thing I always do is I duplicate the background layer. In all these photo editing programs, they all work in layers, and everything has a layer, and it's called background. So I like to duplicate it, so whenever I make any changes, I can always look back at what the original scan looked like. Now, the first thing I would like to do is put this together, all right? And then there's a neat little tool over here called the lasso. And I like what's called polygonal, or you could say polygonal, whatever you want. All right. And what I do is I take the disparate part, the part that's smallest, it's furthest away in some cases, and I'm going to do this really quick for demonstration purposes. All right. And I am going to select. And what I'm doing, I just click and push up, and I also very much recommend that when you do photo editing that you get a tablet, and I use what's called an Intuos tablet, and I could show it to you right now and lift it up, but then I would mess up my selection here. So as soon as
you're working with a pen instead of a mouse.
I'm working with a pen instead of a mouse.
Okay.
And I'm not click click drag click drag click drag as my forearm begins to hurt. You know, I don't recommend you work on photos with a mouse. You know, it's not good for your body.
So is that
body.
That's a little more expensive too.
Okay, here it is, okay?
What is that?
It looks like a mouse pad. This is by a company called Wacom, WACOM. And the model I use is called the Intuos, Intuos. And this is actually old. In fact, everything I have is old, and I'm getting old, but I don't care. You know, I can't be spending money to keep up with everything, okay? But when you go to that website, you'll find things like this on various levels of size. I recommend something what's called about 6x8, or they have much smaller ones, and those are okay. I think you should get one a little bigger. And you're gonna look at 100, maybe 200 bucks, but what is that? Imagine the surgery and all the money you're going to pay to deal with carpal tunnel syndrome. It's real. Okay? It'll save. I'm telling you. You won't get it with this, and you got good posture. Okay? Okay, anyways, I got this selection going, and there's these marching ants. Can you see these marching ants?
Yes.
Right? Okay? That's called a selection. And then what I want to do, I want to make the selection a little soft on the edge, because I don't want people to see, boom, where all these pixels start showing up. I want to see a little dithering there. All right, so I do a radius of 1 pixel. That's might even be too much. And then all I do is I go to Edit, Copy. And I'm not doing a lot of keyboard shortcuts, because that just confuses people, especially beginners. Then I go to Edit, Paste. Anyway, I look here in the layer palette, and you'll see there's that layer I just pasted. Now watch what happens. I grab the Move tool over here in my tool palette, and I just move this piece, and I zoom out. Now of course you see the other layer underneath there. No problem, I can just turn those off. Oops. Turn that off. All right, what did I do wrong here? You know what I should have done? I should have chopped it out, cut it out instead of copy. Let's go back. Instead of doing edit copy, we're gonna do edit cut. All right? Then we do edit paste. There we go. Now I can turn this off on the bottom. Use my move tool. All right? Now, as you see, it's not quite right. No problem. I mean, it's not going to be right all the time. So what I do is I go to Edit. I use Photoshop, the big Photoshop, and the commands are a little different sometimes. And there we go. Transform, free transform. That's under Image.
What makes a good scan?
What is a selection?
What are layers?
What is resolution?
What is a JPEG?
What is TIFF?
What is RGB?
How do I crop a picture?
What is a zoom tool?
What is a clone stamp?
What are levels?
My name is Eric Basir, and I have produced this unique photo restoration and retouching foundations video course to answer all these questions and more. In my classes and workshops, I have taught hundreds how to preserve and restore their personal photographic collections with Adobe Photoshop and Adobe Photoshop Elements. Now you can have me as your personal instructor in this 10-lesson course. After studying the videos and easy-to-read workbook, you'll finish with a firm foundation of how to use Adobe Photoshop or any other photo editing program confidently and correctly.
In the menu image. And I just move these, you see what I'm doing? I'm clicking around this area here and it rotates it. Or I could do it like that, whatever. Or I could, you know, do it to the music, you know. But I have to, and then I could put it in the middle here and just kind of, you know, shift it in. We got some stuff happening here. And then once I got it close, I can use the cursor, the arrow keys on my keyboard, you know, and adjust like so. Now, is this perfect right now? Almost. So I hit return on my keyboard and it executes the command. But it's not necessarily going to be perfect all the time. And so when I do the demonstration, we're going fast. But I would like to show you how you could make it look perfect. And we're just going to do one section, okay? Because I don't want to spend a whole day on just one picture, all right? So I've put this together. There's no reason why I'm really going to take it apart, in my opinion. All the details that I need. I'm clicking that little eye icon right here. See this? To turn that off and on, just to check. Make sure I'm not covering up anything that should be there. It's fine. I will merge that layer down. Let me show you. So I go to this little menu here and I go merge down. And it moves that cut piece into the main piece there. So now it's one picture, right? Now what I can do, if I like that, let me duplicate that layer again, dragging it here, it'll duplicate, or go here to the menu and duplicate layer. And then I grab what I think is so great from Photoshop Elements 8 or above. Does anyone have any version of Elements below number 9? Version 9. All right, good. So this is version, I use a really low version here. They're like at
30. You're assuming we work with Photoshop.
Yeah.
Some are. Whether I use it or not, that's
not my computer, but yeah. That's just another folder that I haven't gotten into.
You know, I'm trying to inspire you to greatness today. So I want you to use
tomorrow.
I want you to use.
Do you do house calls?
I want you to use Elements. And by the way, now that you have come to this class and you've honored me with your presence, and the Cary Area Public Library has honored me with a nice check, you count as a student. And what that means is you can call me or email me anytime and say, hey, I got this problem. Help me out. Well, I can't help you with your taxes, but I can help you with your Photoshopping. Okay, so you go to call me up, and I'm stuck, you know, and I'll just tell you, well, just email it to me, let me see. And maybe I'll even make a video of it. Sometimes I do that, and then I put it on my YouTube channel, and then you get to see how I did it. You know, so whatever, just stay in touch. I don't want you to wait 3 years to ask me a question. Yeah, I'll ask them in a couple years. Okay, I hope I'm around. All right, well anyways, so here's the neat little tool in Photoshop Elements 9 and above called Healing Brush. So I click on that, it looks like a Band-Aid, all right? And I'm gonna go there, and I'm gonna, and all I do is I go Alt, how many people have Macintoshes in here? All right, so I'm gonna say both. I'm gonna say Alt, Option. When I say Alt, Alt is for Macintosh, I'm sorry, Alt is for PC, and Option is a Mac word. It's the same button. Alt, Option, click a nice area of the roof, and then click and wow. And I make that awful crease go bye-bye. All right, so here we go again. Alt, Option, click. Now be careful, because you want the tiles to match in the same row. You want them to be, you don't want to be sloppy. Don't be sloppy with your restoration, please. I mean, I have to say that because you're paying me maybe to do it.
So it was just click on the Band-Aid.
The Band-Aid tool is your tool. But you have to use it. You have to Alt Option click and then what and paint.
So
and
you
brush.
Have to find a spot.
You have to find a spot.
You want yeah. to put.
Now here's exactly you it's called a source. And then your target is the place you're getting rid of. And in my course, which is now all online, I have it all on demand now. You don't. A lot of them aren't on DVD anymore because I can't even get the packaging anymore, you know, for the videos. But I give you exercises to go through. And I highly recommend that course. All right. Now, what happens if I use the healing brush over here? Let's see. I'm not really expecting you to answer, but I just want to try it. Let's see what happens. Not bad. Not bad. Sometimes, though, what happens when you do that, it'll replicate the white. I want to mess it up. See? That's not so pretty. So you have to be careful where you're sourcing from when you Alt Option clicked.
Very cool.
So that's not bad. That's passable to me. Now, if this was a close-up of that window and we had the crease, it wouldn't look so pretty. Ah, see, there's an example. So you see, let me zoom in here. So what I did, see how I gave a weird spot in there? It didn't really match. Oh, I can see, I don't know. It's not so great. Well, anyways, so there's an example, okay? And then I would apply the same principle here. Now, we have a gentleman here who also has Elements, and he likes to experiment with what's called the spot healing brush. Spot healing brush is nice too because it's just like the healing brush, but you can save a step and not do the Alt Option click. But sometimes it doesn't work. And usually when I'm demonstrating it, when I want to show something, I can't show how it doesn't work, you know. So anyways, I pick up when I choose spot healing brush, all I do is get a brush, yeah, about as bigger than my crease, and I just wipe.
Yep.
Not bad.
Not bad.
It kind of blurred it a little bit, but that's my eye. You may say, ain't nothing wrong with that, Eric. Looks good to me, but I'm buying it. You know, let's see what happens when I do this. Not bad. Not bad. Not bad. Sometimes, though, it gums it up. And typically, if you're, see, it kind of blurred it in here.
I was gonna say, it looked kind of blurry in that last area.
There you go, see? And if your brush isn't big enough, too, that can be a problem.
But the dog doesn't look good anyway.
But, yeah, it's like, man.
They've got a dog in that spot.
Yeah. Well, you know, we didn't have, you know, fancy lawnmowers back then. So anyways, that is cool, isn't it? Okay, so what I'm going to do, hold your hand there. Don't give up on me. I'm going to save this. And what I like to do is give it a slightly different file name. So I'm going to do -R1. I don't do this for every time I save. But this is just my working copy. Now, when you save as TIFF, when you're in Elements or PaintShop Pro or GIMP, they're going to ask you what type of image compression. And I always choose what's called LZW, not ZIP, not JPEG, LZW compression. It makes the file a little bit smaller. And especially if you did a nice big scan at, you know, what I recommended, it's nice to have the file a little more smaller, a little smaller. Hit OK. And it says it including layers will increase the file size. Yes, I have a layered version. Now, one other thing I want to tell you, that if you're in Photoshop or Photoshop Elements, there is a file format called Photoshop. No surprise. You can save as that too, and that's lossless. Only issue with that is someone who doesn't have Photoshop may not be able to open it. All right? That's the only issue. And Photoshop's been around for a while, but they are owned by a big giant company that seems to be stumbling and making stupid mistakes, so who knows how long they'll be in business. So, obviously you can tell I have a problem with Adobe. But let's go now to the other picture. Let me close this. I had a question back there.
Yeah.
Sorry. Yes.
Well, it's kind of, I have this gigantic picture of my grandparents and the top of it's all torn off. It doesn't affect their part of it, just the their faces or anything, just the photo itself.
All right.
So you would basically scan the whole entire thing and have to piece it all together.
Yeah.
And then correct what.
I would do that.
Okay.
I would do that. Yep. Yep. When I was showing scanning in parts though, sometimes when you go to, here I go again. I keep going to things. Let me try some photo merge. New photo. Okay, good. So when we scan different parts of an oversized picture, we can go to File, New, Photo Merge, Panorama.
Oh, okay.
And what we can do, we can go in here, browse, and we can go pick up all those scans of that big picture, put it in, and tell it to run. And it will try to stitch them together.
Okay.
I recommend that. Mm-hmm. Now, what I did here, though, was just put together a little postcard. Photo Merge, as long as I have them as separate files in their own layer, it might have done it easily too. But okay, so let's go to this. And what I want to do, because I see your heads are starting to turn, is I want to rotate image rotate 180. All right. So now we have an issue. So, ma'am, could you explain to me? You were saying something about the writing here.
When I look at it on the screen now, it's wonderful. When I look at it on the card, I can hardly read it.
Yeah. Okay. Good. So let's do this. You want to read it on the scan. This it's all you want to do. You just rotate it, and you can you can do that selection and put it together like I did. Now here's another thing that you can do, and let's just say it's really faded.
Yeah.
Like you say, you can hardly see the original. So let's just say, you say it looks great now. Well, let's say you look at it and you say, I still can't read it. All right. Did anyone bring? Yeah, I'm going to jump to another picture, actually. Did anyone bring a faded one up here to me? Like, really faded?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Yours is?
It's a small one.
Could you please come up here? I have a lot here, and I don't want to make a mess. And I want to.
Another table, Eric?
No, we'll be all right. Yeah, if people kept coming, though, I'm like, you know, and I had another hour, yeah. Let's see. Ooh. Yeah, that's not too faded. I've seen worse, but thank you. It's not faded enough. Oh, but yeah, this is cool. Let's do this.
Yeah.
All right, so let me put, this is, the postcard with the handwriting was Jan. So, okay, I just wanted to make sure I put it in the right spot. All right. So let's do this. Is that? Okay, yeah. And let's go to preview. Yeah, so what I'm going to show you with this picture, you can also apply it to handwriting. There is a tutorial that I have on my website called Photo Document Restoration. Actually, it's there too. Okay, I still have the DVDs. Yeah, see, the DVDs, I'm not making them anymore because, like I said, even the cases are hard to get now, and so I just have everything on demand, so I have it there, but I'm going to do something like what you see there. You might see there. All right. So let's change this, actually get rid of these crop. Make a new one, click and drag. And I'm going to tell it, by doing that, I'm telling it, look, just scan the whole area, don't scan the whole bed. That'll speed it up. And here's something interesting. Because it's a small picture, it's at 100%. Look at the target size. It's 2x4. So, you know, you might want to see it bigger. You know, and then with tiny pictures like this, I like to definitely enlarge them because you always want them big, especially these old pictures. So let's try 200. All right, it won't take too long. And of course, the bigger your scans are, the more RAM you have to have in your machine. It's called memory, random access memory. So keep in mind that when you're scanning, when you're dealing with images, you got to have a lot of RAM. It's good. When you get a computer, upgrade the RAM, because these pictures take up a lot of that memory, and it just slows the computer down, and sometimes it crashes. Yes, sir?
What PPI are you scanning in?
So that's 300. I always do 300, and then I scale it in magnification within the scanner. Now, if I'm going to scan a negative, then I crank it up all the way. Sorry, a 35mm negative. Then I crank it up to the highest that the scanner does, which is typically 1,200 pixels per inch. And you may think, wow, that's huge. But remember, it's a tiny image area. All right? And if you do 300 ppi at 100% of a 35mm negative, you're not going to be able to enlarge it very much. See, it all depends on the original. All right, let's go open this up.
So basically, you're telling the scanner to only scan the image and not the rest of the
right.
bed.
It saves time. And then let's just say I had four of them on there. I could set crop marks for each one of them, and it'll scan each one of them individually, which would be good if I showed that. Okay, so this is not so faded as most pictures. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of show you what to do with a faded picture, how to get, you know, overall. You notice I didn't crop it. This is just for demonstration today. All right. So what I do, as usual, I'll duplicate that background layer. So layer, duplicate layer. And then I go to what's called enhance, adjust lighting. And you might think shadows, highlight, brightness, contrast. Nah. Go to levels. All right. And what I want to do, I want to actually adjust the color levels in red, green, and blue channels. And why are you concerned about that? All right. Well, when the scanner's scanning, what is it looking for? It is looking for red, green, and blue. It's using light. All right. So I want to work with whatever language this was working with. And by doing that, I can improve the color and improve the contrast. So I switch in levels to red. And I want to move the black and the white sliders to the edge of the mountain. I believe this mountain here is the white part. So to keep from confusing people, I am going to crop right now. So I go to my crop tool over here, click and drag. Now, I'm going to warn you, this is going to be a sloppy crop. I don't want you to be so sloppy like me. And I'm going to move it in. Hit return. All right. Yeah, there's a little white on there. I don't want to show that either. All right. Now I go to enhance, adjust lighting levels. Good, that's what I want. Go to the red, bring the black slider, which means shadows, bring the white slider, which means white or highlight. Then I go to the green channel, move the black, move the white, to the edge of this, what's called a histogram of mountain. And all that is that's literally all the pixels built up. It's showing you how many pixels are built up near the highlight, the bright range, and how many pixels are built up near the dark range, and how many pixels are built up in the middle range. I go to the blue. All right, and I hit OK. Now watch this, I'm gonna turn off this layer, turn it on. So how about it, what do you think? Improvement? And if you do that with the text, you'll see the text even more. And in some cases, the text is so faded, you might have to go to levels and work in what's the composite, the RGB, and just crank it. Move the black all the way in. And sometimes when you do that, you might even see writing in somewhere hidden. Now that's brute force. But sometimes you gotta do that in order to see the text. So the handwriting is so faded. You know what I mean? So let's move to another picture. Any questions?
You could get rid of those spots by doing that painting thing that you did before, right?
Yeah, good question. So can I use that healing brush, that clone stamp? What do I need to do? So let's, this is a great question. And let's see what happens. So let's go to the spot healing brush. Let's make a bigger brush. So you have to enlarge the brush from here or use your bracket keys. I like to use the bracket keys. Let's wipe that out. Not bad.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, it works. Like I said, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work.
So if you did that on the face, what?
Yeah, let's see what happens. Ooh, isn't that pretty?
Oh.
Look at.
Maybe that's a mold.
So what do you think my problem is? Maybe the brush should be smaller.
Smaller.
Yeah, so let's try it. There you go.
Oh, yeah.
Not bad, not bad. Gotta be careful. And sometimes you have to use the clone stamp tool, which is over here. And I always recommend learning with that first. And that literally copies. So let's just say there was a big crease. Let's see. Oh, perfect. Perfect, perfect. So this is a little, this actually might be on the print like a piece of dust that we could probably just blow off, but Eric was rushing and he didn't do it right. But this is the only scan I have. So I'm gonna try the healing brush on that. You know, not so pretty. I think that's pretty rough.
But it's better than what else.
Yeah, but let's try to do better. So let me undo. What I'm going to do, I'm going to try the healing brush, see if that works. Yeah. Let's try the clone stamp. That's over here. Looks like a rubber stamp. All right. Make the. All right. This is where clone stamp is better than healing brush. Because it is actually copying what I did option click for. I option click here, and it's like, okay, I will rubber stamp that. You know, they say rubber stamp it, rubber stamp it. You know, I don't know, does anyone use rubber stamps anymore? I do, I endorse my checks with them. You know, like this check that the Cary Area Public Library gave me. I'm gonna stamp it, rubber stamp it. Yeah, for deposit only, just in case someone finds it, you know. But anyways, I wanted to show you that. So it also addresses what we were talking about, sir. We were saying clone stamp, healing, spot healing. Which tool do I use? Well, it depends. You know, what's working, what's not working.
And try everything and figure out what's better in the long run, right?
Yeah, agreed. Try it all.
And usually you can undo.
And you can undo. You can undo. Yeah, there's a here's my pen. But usually you can undo, and let me show you. Where is it? Here it is. So down here, This is called Undo History. Isn't that nice? And I can go backward in time. There's that spot coming back, right? Now here is the trick though. Just something you should know is that as soon as I close this picture, all that history is gone. And when I open the picture up, I'm like, oh, where's all my history? Mm-mm. It doesn't save it. It doesn't save it. That's why I work in layers. So I can turn off layers and copy or whatever. You know, like if there's something in this layer underneath, I can get my selection tool. I'm like, why did I get rid of that spot? That's actually his lapel pin. So I copy it, I turn this layer back on, and I paste. There it is. Oh, good, he's got his lapel pin back, you know. That's what comes in handy working in layers. Now, if you're not working in layers, you're like, oh, I got to find the original file, but then it's cropped differently, and it's reset. Oh, no, what do I do? Okay. Now, I want to move on to... I want to take a look. Any questions, please? Please ask. Is there a hand? Just ask.
I had a color picture.
A color picture? Yeah, let's do a color picture. It's Diane?
No.
Where's
it's in the envelope.
Where's your, who's your, what's your name?
Dana Floor.
This one?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you.
There's two pictures in there.
Oh, good, 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 good. Oh, look at that. Yeah. 1970s.
Something like that, yeah.
That was like before the internet. It's, I don't know, I have fond memories of that time and things were very inconvenient though. I would not be able to do what I'm doing now. It'd be very different. Everything I'm doing and learning even. Imagine what internet's gonna do to higher education.
It won't be colleges, they'll be doing it on a computer.
They're I tell you, those colleges, they really, they've been...
Where do you buy your white gloves?
I'm not telling. No. You could get these gloves at, you know...
Michael
Jackson's estate. Yeah. Wait. You said Michael Jackson? I just moonwalk.
Work at it some more.
Yeah.
Whoa. Oh, whoa. She just said I got to work on my moonwalk.
I hear a challenge coming.
Uh-oh.
Up.
Okay, stop. Eric, they're not gonna have you back here again. Okay, so where do you get these gloves? So you can get them at any archival material store, any genealogical store. You go to Fun Stuff for Genealogists or any place, any conference. If you go to any, there's going to be some nice conferences this year. Go to one, and you're going to find at least a couple people selling these. And you can get the cotton ones. You can get the ones that have synthetic. They're a little smoother. This is actually from my photo lab days when I worked at Wolf Photo. You know, the ancient film?
Oh,
yeah. And I was slicing negatives and almost chopped my thumb off. But let's talk about color. All right. So, yeah, let's just... I'm gonna go at 100% size just to speed it up. And we're gonna save it as JPEG, right?
No.
TIFF.
All right, just checking. Just checking. Just checking. You know this is the church. You know this is the church of TIFF. That's where I'm from, and you know every other church, they're going to hell, you know, because they believe in JPEG. So. I want you to join my religion of TIFF so that you can have everlasting
photographs,
digital images. All right, so let's go to Elements, and I will close. And you know, the more pictures you have open too, that uses up a lot of RAM. I didn't do anything with you. File open, number 4. All right, nice thumbprint in front of her face. All right, this is why you do not put your fingers in your pictures. Naughty, naughty. She's like, he's embarrassing me, I'll laugh. But As soon as I'm going to email and tell them, hey, don't make fun of my thumbprints. All right, let's do a crop. Let's just do a crop.
That was my sister.
And, yeah, hair was a lot less complicated back then. All right. So let's duplicate the background layer and duplicate. All right, I can't do anything with this. No, just kidding. All right, so let's talk about the faded color, all right? Let's deal with that first. We know about cracks, and I've shown you some things. Let's just deal with the overall color. So we'll go to enhance, adjust color, adjust lighting, levels. Again, I'm like driving someone else's car right now, so I get a little confused. Let's go to red. Get the sliders. I think this spike of white
is that white dot.
Is that tear, so I'm actually gonna go past it. But I can always go back later if I think it's overkill. It's hit okay. Now I'm gonna turn it off. Before, after. It's a little better. It's not great, but it's a good start, right? And from here, you want to improve it. Sometimes this works also. Enhance, adjust color, and adjust hue/saturation. So when that's a saturation, you're not going to adjust the hue in this one, but you're going to adjust the saturation of color. Sometimes helps. Sometimes. So what I'll do is just go with the saturation slider. Now, if I go all the way to the right, you see what happens. It's like, whoa, too much. But sometimes, you know, it can help. Just right. So here's before, after. There's a whole area we can actually brush color in. Or brush color out, and it's kind of hard to see on the screen sometimes. So I go over here to what's called the brush tool, and here's something interesting called color replacement tool. I haven't played with it. I definitely recommend experimentation beyond what I'm showing you, and I want to check. All right, and what I'm going to do is hit my bracket keys on my keyboard to make this a big brush, actually. You see a big brush. And I click the Alt-Option key on my keyboard, and it turns the pointer into a eyedropper. I like this color on her sweater here, so I click one time, and I let go. And I want to paint it, and then I go right here, sorry. Last thing. This is actually somewhat of an advanced technique, so please don't feel bad if you don't really follow what I'm doing. And I change the mode to color. I hope it's here. Here it is. And oops, made my brush small. And I paint. Now I lost a lot of color in her flesh tones. So I don't necessarily have to brush over that, but at this stage, I will have to probably put those flesh tones back in, but as you see, I'm getting rid of the yellow. So before, after. So see, it's more consistent throughout. And if I like her flesh tones here, which they're okay, I can also brush that in. Up here we have, again, this big flare coming in, maybe the film got a little exposed. And I can paint that color out.
So are you actually taking away color or adding color?
Right now, I'm painting in color. I'm painting in a dark kind of color. And I can also, to darken this area. I hope it's here. It should be the burn tool. Is that in Elements? Does anyone remember? Any of you experts out here?
What tool are you looking for?
Yeah, the burn tool.
The burn tool?
So let's do it this way. Let's do a selection. Because this is actually, I'm sure this was really in the dark, this area. I'm very positive of that. And I select this area. And I make a really soft edge. Let's say, let's try 15. It might be too soft. But let's see what happens. Enhance, adjust lighting levels. And I move the middle tone, the middle slider. Darken that up a little bit. So here's before, after. All right? So that's some things you can do with color. There's also there's some advanced things that Elements can't do that I can only do with Photoshop, but I don't want to get too distracted. Any questions?
So when you were getting rid of that yellowish green on, like you said, the overexposure, you know, many photographs sometimes would come out that way, you know, just from the negative. So you could adjust the color on the
side. Yeah.
Get rid of the greenish yellow or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Here I'm helping get rid of the green from the thumbprint.
Oh.
Not getting rid of the thumbprint at this time. Sometimes also you have to do the old thing, and that is rebuild things with color. You just got to paint. You got to rebuild. You know, like for example, here I made a new blank layer. All right. And I'm going to try to actually paint. So what I do is I Alt-Option click the area of color that I'm interested in, and I just paint.
Oh, and you are getting rid of your thumbprint.
Yeah. You know. And you got to get you got to experiment with the brush size. You got to experiment with the, let's see if this is showing here. This, when I click up here. The hardness of the brush, you know, sometimes the edge is too hard, you know. You got to soften the edge of the brush. So, and then you turn this layer off and on. And so, you know, and we could conceivably do the same with the face. It'd be a little more work. And there are some things such as adding noise and stuff to match the grain, because, you know, the pictures have grain, you know, little bumpy, or you got to match that. So, any questions?
How would you fill in that chunk that's missing here?
Which missing?
Down at the bottom.
Over here. Okay. Well, let's see. We zoom out. We look at what's there. Maybe we can use parts of her clothing here, or we can paint it in manually. There's some water damage down here. Let me try something. But you had a question back there?
No,
yes? Okay. So let me make a new blank layer. And let me choose the clone stamp tool. And let's just do something rough. And I make the brush a little bigger. Alt-Option, click. And paint. And now Alt-Option click over here, paint. And then I'll take the healing brush. Let's take the spot healing brush. Because you'll see I've kind of duplicated part of the fold in the clothing here, so I want to wipe that out. Undo that, that looked weird. But let's see, before, after. Not bad. You know, and there's the sleeve looks a little weird here, so I'd make another layer, you know, and I would take the baby's, I would take the baby's color here from the sleeve and try to rebuild the sleeve a little bit. Like that.
Artist.
You know, and I could put another layer under that. And I name all my layers, but for today, just for speed, I'm not gonna waste time doing that. I just want to show you what you're, you know, capable of. There's a little shadow to separate her sleeve from the dress.
Oh, wow.
So if I go, so zoom in a little bit, Eric. Hang on. You know, there you go. That's how you rebuild. It'll force you, if you don't have drawing skills, painting skills, it'll force you to get them.
So can you bring back on I brought one like the tin type where the ghosts are disappearing. So
yeah, those are always fun to do because they're so exotic. But they're actually not any different as far as, this was Diane, right? Dana. Here it is. Thank you. Tintype, yeah. So this is,
yeah.
This might be a daguerreotype. And it might be an ambrotype actually. These are always trouble because, you know, they're sealed. They're sealed inside a case, all right? And and be careful, they'll scratch your glass. So put them down carefully. You can take them apart. I've done it to get a better scan. But I'm not saying you need to do that. And let's see. I'm going to scan it. Yeah, this almost looks like an ambrotype to me. And there are different processes. Ambrotypes are really tough because the emulsion is on the glass. It's actually part of the glass. The image is part of the glass. I don't think this is a tintype in a case. How do I what?
How do you tell if it's a tin or if it's a...
Well, if it's tin, you know it's because it's a piece of metal. It's more, technically it's not tin, it's iron. So it's more like an iron type. But if it's a piece of metal and there's a picture on it, it's a tin type. But if it's glass and you see different levels in it, that's an ambrotype. And daguerreotypes, you don't see a lot of those actually. I don't remember if I scanned this yet. Let me go ahead. So yours, let's see yours.
I'm guessing it's tin.
Me too. Yeah, that's a tin type. Yeah. Let me just keep that right here for a second. Don't forget I have it.
Okay. They can be your family. I don't know who they are.
Okay.
They were just in my family album.
Hang on. Let me just save this. Close it. LZW. Compression is good. All right. Let me open.
That's a cool
picture. That's cool. Yeah, look at them. All right. So if we apply the same principles with the levels... All right, and I just did a keyboard shortcut just to speed it up. And let's see what I can do. Rough. You know, this is.
Whose picture is that?
Is that Lauren?
Where is that from?
I believe it's from Canada.
Wow. What a couple.
Interesting. I want to see them.
Yeah, it's. Yeah. Let me try something else.
Yeah.
Let me try something a little. I'm not expecting y'all to catch this, so I'm curious. There we go. There we go.
Too bad you can't get detail in his clothes.
Yeah, I blew the contrast out. Yeah, we're not going to get anything from his clothes until we can, unless we can get the image out of the case. And I don't have time, and I don't want to mess with that right now.
He's just wearing a suit.
Yeah, yeah. I'm sure we can get more detail.
Very cool.
By taking this thing apart, but I'm not willing to do that.
Is it hard to take it apart?
No. You just pry it. You can put it back together. I've done that. I've taken it apart and put it back together. But like I said, it's, you know, you got to take a chance with that. I want to go to this tintype. I'm sorry I haven't gotten to everybody's. I'm always hoping to get to one of everybody, but never happens. You just gotta be lucky that I'm like. But if
I'm happier that I didn't bring Mike. No, I just couldn't find the one I wanted because it was totally black. You know, there's people in there. You can see them, but
all right.
Totally
so
black.
You have to scan that in right away, okay?
Yeah.
All right.
And then the tins continue to fade.
Yeah.
They get dark.
I can show you mine.
I scanned one of hers. They get dark and dark until they're black.
This isn't a tintype or anything. It's just a photograph, and it's just totally black.
Is there any way you can put them in a special container that they don't get black?
I've seen those, by the way. I don't know what the process was with those.
No.
I mean, yeah, it's just going to have light. Keep it out of the light. Yeah. That helps.
That's why you scan them and doctor them.
Yeah.
Photography originally wasn't all that permanent.
Right. Let's open this. I'll go ahead and save that. Just, now, by the way, if I worked on your picture today and you want what I did, you can pay me. No, just kidding. Just email me and I'll send you the file, okay? I mean, what am I going to do? Keep it hostage. Like, oh, I want your picture. Feel free. There's no charge. I mean, if you want to send me a tip, great. I'll take it. But you want to send me a tip with your TIFF. A TIFF for a tip. No. You don't have to do that. But I won't stop you. Okay. So let's, that was a real sloppy placement. And I want to go like this. It's kind of a sloppy crop, all right? But again, I want to show you the same principle, right? Go to levels.
It looks like it. Oh, could you fix his eye?
Wow, yeah, he does have a little eye going over there.
It's just becoming more apparent. It's a doctor.
Yeah.
Maybe it's a glass eye.
Fix that, will you?
Yeah.
Fix his eye.
He's in the wrong place. Wow, look at that.
It's a cool picture.
Wow.
Yeah, that's a little improvement.
That's a lot.
And then
mine.
What I like to do sometimes, if you have this picture and you know it was a black and white, you can go to Enhance Adjust Color, Adjust Hue and Saturation, and desaturate completely. And then it gives it that nice, genuine black and white look, but it's still a color file, you know?
What happens if it was sepia, and you've made it black and white?
Well, okay, so, yeah, you've gotten rid of that if it was a sepia. But here's a good question, though. What if I want to make it sepia? How about that?
Okay.
So we've now desaturated it, which would be the first step. So the second step is enhance, adjust color, adjust hue and saturation. And we click this little box called colorize.
Yeah.
All right, now I know he's green. He's like, whoa, is this like a shamrock shake or what's up here, man? So just move the hue. See? And you can get all kinds of interesting effects. And then you can adjust the saturation of that hue. And now it's got a neat little sepia look.
Okay.
Look at that. Right? And sometimes you'll have a sepia tone, and then it is a real sepia tone, but it's got discolorization going on, right? Like little splotches of some other color. Something got spilled on it, whatever. You just desaturate it like I did, and colorize it like I did. You know, go back and you can do that. However, a lot of times we think something is sepia tone, like all these pictures here. I'd say all these pictures that have like a brown tone to it, they're not sepia.
They're just discolored.
They're discolored, yeah. They turn yellow. And what happens to the leaves when they fall, right? The green leaves when they fall, they turn yellow, they turn red. What are your pictures made out of? Wood, paper, trees. What do they do when they die? They turn yellow. All of our pictures that are on paper are slowly dying as they turn yellow. Question.
Was there a period when sepia was really big? Can you tell anything from if you really have a true sepia picture?
I have not spent much time in that realm. Maureen Taylor's got some great stuff.
And we have at least one of her books.
Yeah.
And I was going to say, Lori, with that picture of yours with her hair, we do have a book on helping to date photographs through costume.
Yeah.
And
that's Maureen Taylor's book.
Hair, yes.
Yeah.
It gets into hair. And they're also, if you're trying to date photographs to figure out who the people are, you know, like these guys, take a look not only in the genealogy books for Maureen Taylor and stuff, but also look in like the fashion books.
We have
some encyclopedias of fashion.
Yes.
And
they'll
go through when did men wear those huge high hats.
Yes.
And
the necktie. Yeah.
You know, double-breasted, single-breasted,
that's right.
Wide-lapels,
that's right.
Whatever.
That's right. Yeah, I'm working on a project. I'm doing a historical fiction graphic novel, and I'm illustrating it now. And it's in 18th century Sweden. So all of the costumes that people wear, all the clothing, have to look 18th century, have to look period. And I've been studying that, and I can bear witness, when you look at fashion and study it, you'll start to see, oh, I get it. I get it. That's this era. That's this era. That's that era. Oh, wait, that's a little too recent. You start to see it even in 50-year increments. You really see a big difference, you know. So definitely, yeah. It's hard work, you know. But if you catch Maureen Taylor at a conference, you can pay her a fee and she'll consult and probably
actually,
get you.
She has been in town. She was at the Fox Valley Genealogical Society.
Yeah.
And it was neat. You guys ever have a chance to do some of these one-on-one consultations, you could sign up online, and I think you paid like $50 or something, maybe it was $25, but you had like 15, 20 minutes with her to look at photographs. And this summer at the MCIGS or MCGIS conference, who's coming? Because we can have a consultation with them. Lori, do you
can't remember if it's Josh Taylor from Roadshow, or there's somebody.
Oh, by the way, everybody, I was doing photo restoration roadshow. I've been doing it for quite a few years. Mm-hmm. Myself. This is one of the, every time I do a video, it's a roadshow. Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, definitely, and it's worth it. Let me tell you, Maureen Taylor knows her stuff.
Yeah.
Hey, okay, Maureen Taylor, if you're watching this, I need you to tell all your people that I know my stuff. Okay, Maureen Taylor, gotcha. All right. Yeah.
When it comes to a storage of photos, you want to hold on to it for a couple of generations.
Yeah.
What can you do?
Okay, so I got to store photos for a couple of generations. What can I do? You can pray. No. You can store them in PVC-free bags. This is not PVC. Free. This is like, it's leftovers. It's the leftovers. But PVC container, PVC free container, you can get boxes called archival boxes that are lignin free, where they take out a lot of the organic substances that tend to decay faster and which will off gas, making your pictures turn even more yellow. All right? 50% humidity.
Okay.
Stored in 50% humidity. That means not too dry, not too humid. Okay?
Not the basement, not the attic.
Yeah. Yeah. And if it is in the basement or the attic, it's climate controlled. All right? Also, sunlight. Keep it out of sunlight. And make sure it's not stored with other materials such as plastics. Like, okay, here's some old photos and here's my old toys that I used to play with, and they're all in one collection. Well, you know, something may happen, you know, and you know plastic, what it does. It decays also, although it takes thousands of years, but it does decay. So, anybody else have any tips for archiving your prints?
There are places you can write away to. Big one for libraries is University Products. You'll be able to get the gloves. Actually, I had some oversized stuff that I wanted to keep, so I have a box.
It's archival
the
box.
Big box. It's archival.
And where do you keep that box?
I keep it in a closet on the second floor of the house. It's out of the way. It's in the dark.
Yeah.
It's not closed up, though, because you do want... And inside, I've got one of my pictures that I wanted Eric to work on.
Yeah.
I also purchased... I can't get one out, but there, it's archival paper. It's a folder. It's just paper folded. And so I interleave my pictures inside like a folder.
Okay.
Yeah.
So she's a lovely person.
All these are good.
Yeah.
It's a folder. The picture's in the folder, okay. And then there's another folder with another picture. And since I had 20, I've got a lot of goofy stuff in here. But you know, I'd rather have stuff in there holding it down than it floating around.
Yeah, it's good. Yeah.
You can also get the photo boxes through University Products.
Yep.
That are about this big. You see them at Joann's and Michael's, but they aren't necessarily living proof. You've got to watch it. And they come with, you know, the old photo envelopes when you went to the photo shop. You don't want to have your negatives up against your photos either.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, if you can, you get little sleeves and slide each one in there individually, you know. Yes.
Okay. I kind of want to now finish, like, you've got the product all done. You've fixed the picture.
Yeah.
And now you're ready. If you want to put it on the wall, you want to copy it.
You want to print it.
Print it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's what.
Yeah.
What or where or what should you do is the best way? Should you put it on a, you know,
right,
a memory stick and take it somewhere?
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
Where do you take it without a wolf?
Yeah.
Well, okay, so here's we're talking digital now, right? We've right. scanned it in, it's all digital. So you can use Shutterfly.com, you can use Kodak, you can use Sam's Club, Walgreens, CVS. They all print on photographic paper. Or you can print yourself with your printer, and HP's good for that, Epson's good for that, Canon's good for that. I think it's very expensive to print your own color pictures, you know, that you want to make in an album or something or give away. I think that's really expensive. I don't do it anymore. I use a lab. Like, if someone orders a photo restoration from me, I give them the file for free and tell them you can print it anywhere. But if they insist on me having a print done, I send it to a lab. They send me a print back. You know, I don't tell anyone who that is. I'm sorry. But anywhere you can go, you can get good, high-quality photographic prints.
But do you find that sometimes, depending on where you send it, do they shrink the file at all to...
Well, do they shrink the file?
Because, well, sometimes when you send your files to be printed,
yeah,
and they ask you if you wanted to upload,
right,
quick upload,
uh-huh,
I always wonder, is it quick upload because they're making the files smaller, or, I mean, what's...
I don't think so. I don't know. I don't. What company are you talking about?
What have I used? I use Walgreens. I've used...
I don't think they're shrinking... I don't think they're shrinking it in the upload, mm-hmm, because it's in their interest to keep the file at whatever size you have it at, because you might want a big print. You know what I mean? I could be wrong. I don't know. But I would say I don't think they're shrinking it. You know, I don't think that would be in their interest. But if you have a question, email me. Say, hey, Eric, what do you think of this picture? You're going to print it bigger than a stamp? You know. Send it to me. It's easy. I can answer that, like, with my eyes closed. Yes, sir.
One more question.
Yes.
Converting Super 8 movies to CD.
Yeah. So converting Super 8, you know, there were some services I used to recommend, but they're not in business anymore. So if you email me, there was a place that I did find that I recommended to someone that I thought was pretty good,
okay.
Looked reputable.
Okay.
Yeah, because you're like, okay, am I going to give this to you and then you're going to send it somewhere else? You know, that's really what you need to know. Yeah, but I can't, other than that, I can't help you with that. So any other questions? So I guess, you know, we went over a little bit, but I plan to hang around and pack up slowly. Feel free to ask. Please don't go home and, what did he say? And feel ashamed to email or call me. It may take me a while to return. It may take me a day or two or something like that, but if you don't hear from me, send another one, you know, so maybe I accidentally deleted it. I don't know. But please don't get a headache.
Don't forget the sign-up sheet.
Oh, yeah, don't forget that email newsletter. And I have business cards, too. Yes, sir.
If you wanted to scan your pictures in and then burn them to a disk, would you burn them in as TIFF files or JPEGs?
So what did I scan them as? What?
Well, let's leave it up.
Okay, and then I put it...
No, we have to do it.
Let's assume I scanned it as a TIFF, all right? And now I want to put it on a disk to share with someone.
Right.
Yeah, and if I'm concerned that they don't know what to do with files, but I want them to see it, I'm not going to give them a TIFF. I'll give them the JPEG. But if I got space on the disk, I'll give them both.
Well, the TIFF files are so much larger than a JPEG.
Well, if it fits.
You've got a lot of room.
Yeah, well, I'm just saying, if it fits, then do them both. But
And maybe is it also a question of why are you sharing the CD or DVD with the other person? Is it for another archive?
Mm-hmm.
If it's for another archive, then it should be TIFF.
Yes. If this is not just for some family, you just want them to look at the pictures, and it's just an archive, definitely the TIFF. But I would say do both if possible. And DVDs are so huge, big anyways. But if you're gonna send them off, like you wanna donate to an archive, a society or something, give them TIFFs or give them both. You know, that's what I recommend. Find out what they want. Hopefully they'll say TIFF. A lot of great archives out there too, and they scan in color. Scan your black and whites in color, like I say there, so there's lots of detail. And no filters, don't sharpen your pictures. No. No sharpening filters. Like I say in the handout, you could do all that at the end with the one you want to print.
So you're saying basically you're doing a rough scan in TIFF, right?
Yeah.
And any doctoring that you're manipulating, you're doing with settings, you're doing it to your layer, to your copy.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Don't be afraid to display pictures, but don't display the original. Take your original, even if you're like, oh, what did Eric do to restore? Don't worry about what Eric did. Just scan it and print out a nice copy and display the copy. You know, where the sunlight is and whatever pollutants and stuff, you know what I mean? Display the copy, not the original. And beat up the copy. You can throw darts at it and whatever, put gum on it. But it's a copy. It's a copy. No problem. And it looks bad. Looks just like as bad as the worn out as the original. It's okay. It's a copy.